Another issue right now is the president is, let's talk about the president leaving for Davos, coming from other legislators, that this is the president's eighth trip in a span of 7 months. They say he should be focusing on, while it's good that he wants to sell.
And at this point in time, we really need to sell the country. We need to have more investment. Kulang na kulang talaga ang capital natin dito sa bansa. We really need to find a way to bring in more interest, more foreign investment. So, okay.
Speaking of kulang ang capital natin sa bansa, let's move now to the Maharlika Investment Fund. Where are you seeing this so far now? Anong nakikita mo nito on its first year?
So, obviously, we need to first hurdle the Senate, right? So I believe that the Senate will begin. I'm not even sure if the bill has been filed. So they'll probably begin debate or maybe have a debate until, I believe what they said was sometime March. Mm-hmm. That's the initial feedback that I heard. But of course, we can't preempt that, right? We don't know how long the debate will take. But I'm assuming that...
Assuming that the president certifies it as urgent.
But it is. It support, has been certified as
okay.
urgent.
Yes. And,
support, they act on it. Yes.
Yes, and they act on it in the Senate with a supermajority of supporters there. So you're seeing a fruition of this maybe in 2024?
I think it will take at least 6 months to set it up. Why? The most important thing, Karen, is the recruitment of personnel for the fund. That's the most important thing. We've been talking to the various SWFs, the sovereign wealth funds from various countries. And for me, the common denominator really is the quality of the personnel. Mm-hmm. So if the Indonesian SWF, they're all mostly investment bankers from the private sector. So they know exactly what they're doing. And for me, that's the kind of people that we need to recruit. And most of them, when I ask them, why is it that you accepted this job? And most of them would say, for legacy. We want to do this for the country. We want to share our talent and do this for the country. So that's the kind of people that we need to recruit. And that's probably going to take time.
Okay, so you are looking at the Indonesian model, because the Indonesian model is quite interesting because there's something different about it, right? They do, am I correct, Congresswoman, that the Indonesian Sovereign Wealth Fund actually is allowed to get funds from the private sector? Tama ba pagkakaintindi ko?
Yes, and that's also how the Maharlika, well, at least the current version, that's also how it's set up. So. Mm-hmm. Whatever initial funds that we put in from GOCC, so in this case, Land Bank and EBP, that's really just the initial seed. You use that to leverage and to try to bring in more capital from the private sector, both locally and abroad. So it's really just an investment vehicle to try to mobilize as many resources as you can into the country in sectors which have the potential of giving high return and at the same time, will have development outcomes. So for example, energy, right? So mataas ang kita doon, but at the same time, it's really a way to bring down electricity prices for the consumers. So that's really the objective. But in terms of your first question, which is, are you looking at Indonesia as a model? The truth is, there's no one size fits all. That's one of the lessons that we learned talking to various countries and multilaterals. Wala talagang ano eh, it's really customized to your situation.
Country. Yeah.
Yes.
Yes. Because Singapore and Norway are also different. Yeah.
Correct. But and it depends, kasi sana surplus eh, sana may mga investable funds. Depends on that. But for me, Indonesia is we can probably look at them in terms of recruitment and the kind of personnel that they put into the corporation.
All right. Okay. So let's go back to the hearing. When are you planning the hearing? When is this scheduled, Congresswoman?
Well, it has to be read first on the floor and then referred to the committee. And right now, I believe it's the Committee on Economic Affairs and the Committee on Trade and Industry that has joint oversight over the PCT.
Oo. So before, let's talk about bago yung investigasyon. Do you believe the DA is doing all it can? Are there other interventions it can do so that at least instead of the price at 420 to 600, it can at least be down to 300. May kulang ba sa ginagawa ngayon ng DA?
Well, okay, so there's the Kadiwa, and there's obviously first importation, and then there's Kadiwa, and then there's of course ayuda for the farmers, because that's the most important thing. Kasi kung madi-displace ng farmers, you need to help them. Those three mechanisms are in place. For me, the missing element is really cartel enforcement, which is within the jurisdiction of PCC. And that's precisely why I filed this resolution. We keep missing that piece.
Yeah.
Pero right now, it's the PCC that has the power to do dawn raid. Karen, they don't.
Yeah, and they don't.
They haven't done a dawn raid on any firm, right? So, yeah. I mean, they need to be able to use whatever powers Congress gave them for a very important purpose, right? Which is to keep prices of basic food commodities low. Oh. That's their mandate.
Yeah, that's a very interesting point. So they're not really policy making. They're really operational on the ground. They should do raids.
So the policy part, okay naman sila, competition policy, they approve mergers, etc. But I believe it's a little bit lopsided on that. Kailangan talaga ng cartel enforcement. Uh-oh. Yung parang NBI, diba?
All right. Well, on that note, anything you'd like to add, ma'am, before we go?
Well, just Happy New Year. And once and for all, kailangan na talaga natin tundukan ito. Otherwise, baka mapunta pa sa iba pang commodities. There is, I believe, something systemic. And we need to nip that in the bud right now.
All right. Marikina Representative Stella Kimbo, thank you for joining us today, ma'am. Have a good weekend. Thank you.
Thank you.